If you had a warning label, what would it be? Marissa.
You know, I was going to say something along the lines of yours, but I'm going to give this one to you because I feel like I personally have a lot of warning labels when people come towards me. I'm going to say very, like, hyperactive. I am a very, like, jumpy, like, literally will just, like, like,
so
nonstop
say?
Energy. Like, literally go nonstop energy.
Nonstop energy.
Like, I that can go a lot of different ways. I do talk a lot, obviously, why we do have a podcast, but quite literally, if there was ADHD in a person, hi, how are you? It's me.
Yeah,
and that's my warning label.
It was something about static electricity. That's what I used. That'd be you. Static electricity.
Uh-huh.
Mine would be ask hockey question at your own risk.
Yeah, I feel
that. That would be mine. If you ask me a hockey question, you'll be there for a while.
That's how I feel too. Like, I was also going to go like a second one, certified yapper.
Yep.
That's definitely also one of mine. I will not shut up, especially like the same thing, like about Minnesota sports or anything.
That would have been my other one for you. Would have been.
I will not shut up about Minnesota sports.
If I go on your Twitter feed, it's 99%. I'm at this hockey game, this football game, this sporting.
Oh my God. I was literally at, I have to tell a story because it's pertinent to what we're talking about right now. We were at the Wild game and then we went to Tom Reed's and then there was the after party for like Wild people who worked for the Wild kind of start up the season. And one guy, I was with 10K Takes, and he goes, oh, do you know Marissa Voss? And one of the guys is like, yeah, aren't you the one that takes pictures of yourself at sporting events?
Yeah, there it is. You have a label. Heating up, belly, I just heat up. Did you love me? Not a need it, it's a must. Feel the stuff, you know how to keep me up. Icy love, icy like a hockey puck. This life I cannot change. Hit it.
Welcome back to the second episode of This Week in College Hockey. I am one of your co-hosts, Marissa Voss. I'm joined alongside Tony Scott. We are going to be breaking down anything and everything Minnesota, like hockey and also just hockey in general. So this is fun. If you haven't subscribed, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, Spotify, anywhere you listen to literally your podcast, and then also Twitter, Instagram, TikTok. Literally, we're all
any
over
social
it.
Channel. We're there. Mm-hmm. So TikTok, Instagram, YouTube, Facebook.
Do just people still do Tumblr or like?
Never heard of it.
Like MySpace.
Never heard of it.
Any of it? No, we not on
never
that.
Never heard of it. I mean, I've heard of it, but we do not subscribe.
We got to ask our producer. Do you have a MySpace?
No, never had either. And another one I was thinking of is Threads.
Oh,
no.
Threads. We
no.
don't. I don't know if we have a Threads.
No Threads.
That's rough.
Here.
Okay.
Never had a MySpace.
We're Thread-free.
Too young. He's too young for the MySpace.
Yeah, and same. I'm too old for MySpace.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. My gosh.
Our producer's new this year. He's messing with the camera.
He keeps kicking the camera.
We're going to give him a little bit of space.
We're going to kick him. It's okay.
I might kick him. I grew up with brothers, so you better watch out, bud.
All right, let's get this show rolling here. We have a lot of action. I actually went to two games last weekend in Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
Before I get into too much about the hockey itself, I went to a game in a Las Vegas casino for the first time in my career. It was interesting. I was actually amazed that they actually had ice. Inside
that's actually kind of crazy.
They were like not very well prepared. I mean, it was like, did they know there were people coming? I mean, like,
they probably were like, oh, we have no idea how this is going to play out.
There was no, like, no preparation for the press, no preparation for pretty much anything.
No kidding.
The PA guy didn't know the teams. It was a little bit messy on night one. We'll just say that.
Yeah.
It could have been better. I'll just say that.
Mm-hmm.
There weren't a lot of people there. Apparently, the tickets were $190 a session. So
you're kidding.
Obviously, scalping. They got scalped down to a low. If you bought them at $190 last May or April or whatever, you got fleeced because they were selling them for like $30, which they should have been $30 tickets. So it was just kind of in the Orleans Hotel. It wasn't a dump. It was fine for me for one night, but I've stayed in nicer hotels places in Las Vegas than Orleans. I'll just say that. But
I mean, and that's hard too. Like, you're selling it for that much. Isn't this the first time they've done this tournament too?
No, I don't know.
Or is this is the Icebreakers thing a thing?
I don't know how it works. Honest to God, that I'm just gonna give my answer. I don't know enough about college hockey to know how it works. I just feel like they had an icebreaker in Duluth a couple years ago, and it was like Michigan, Providence, UMD, and another good team. Like, that's what it should be.
Mm-hmm.
No offense to Air Force, they're just not in the same class as Minnesota.
Yeah, and I wonder too if it's like with the icebreaker, they wanted to get all of these different like teams from all over the place, kind of a deal. Because you have UMass, you had Minnesota, you have Omaha, you have Air Force, so they're kind of like almost like a we're gonna.
I like that
everything.
They're all from different conferences.
That's what I think the gist of it is to kind of get something where these teams don't play each other a lot, you know, and I almost like that better because you're going to see matchups that you usually don't see in general. And I think the listeners would agree that this is something like you're really going to see Air Force versus Minnesota, or like the Minnesota-Omaha one. That, I mean, we saw that in regionals last year, obviously, so that's not a new one because I was at that game.
Yeah, but that was planned before the regional, so.
Which is also like happenstance, like that, like, you know.
It's not a big deal. So anyway, so that was interesting. That leads us into Omaha winning the icebreaker.
Yeah.
They beat the Gophers 2-1 in a 3-on-3 overtime. They won both their games in overtime. They won 3-2 the night before. Mm. This wouldn't be my best game or worst game candidate, but it was on a fast track.
The
UMass Omaha game on Friday was on a fast track. It'd be one of the worst games I've ever seen. I mean, the hockey was fine, but it was like 1-1. Each team scored in the first, one scored in the first, one scored in the second. So it was like, and then, I mean, just to paint the picture, the arena has 9,000 seats, and there were maybe 400 people in the ring. There were more ushers than there were fans at that point. Ryan?
Quick note, this is the 28th Icebreaker tournament.
Thank you. Yeah, so this was
28th. Is it always in Vegas or does it hop around? Does it say that?
I will get back to you on that.
There we go.
Well, we'll get to that in a second. So I'll give a quick recap. So then it was fun because like 2 minutes left in the game, Omaha scores to go up 2-1.
Mm-hmm.
Like, all right, it's over. There's only been 3 goals in this game. It's over. UMass pulls their goalie and scores. So now it's like, this is good.
Okay,
and
now we're getting to it.
And then it went into overtime, and Omaha scored. Kid from Wisconsin scored. Zach Erdahl, baby. Somewhere in, I want to say he's from Eau Claire, Wisconsin.
We love Erdahl.
To win the game on a 3-on-3 breakaway. He kind of missed on the first part of the breakaway, but he reached back and stuffed it past UMass's goalie. I don't know his name, but he was humongous. This guy was easily 6'6". He might have been closer to 6'8". He was a big, tall drink of water. So they win that game. And then I'm not going to give away my the Gophers win 8-1. I'm not going to spoil. No spoiler on worst game.
Yeah,
they're
coming up soon.
Definitely in the mix for that. Then they beat the Gophers. Omaha beat the Gophers. And
a little bit of revenge from last year.
Yeah, a little revenge. I spoke to a few of the players from Omaha after.
Ooh, who'd you speak to?
I don't want to give away.
I
did speak to
the boys.
Them. The reason I'm saying is because they were saying that's the guy. Is he 6'7"?
He is 6'7". Michael Herbal. Herbal.
Hairball, we'll
Hairball.
Call him.
Hairball.
He was 6'7". Wow, he was
6'7" as
from,
a goalie. My
he's from
God.
Prague, Czech.
Yep.
Oh, there it is. That checks out.
So while talking to some of the Minnesota-born kids from Omaha, they say, yeah, it's just all so brand new. We have 14 new players on the team this year. It's so
14?
Brand new. So, like, the fact that he goes, we didn't really know what we were getting into today. So once we kind of feeling it and gelling it was good. It was fun to watch Garrett Pinimi play, and Garrett was on the team that beat the Gophers. I'm sure that was a sweet victory for Garrett after he left the Gophers, after not getting a lot of playing time with the Gophers. He kind of got thrown in the mix with Charlie Strobel and those guys and Johnny Mittelstadt. They feel like they kind of rotated those guys in and out. So it was good to see him getting first line minutes.
Yeah, I love that.
Kids always had first line minutes, so it was fun to see him playing well. They got the dub, so that would be the first thought of the weekend. What else we got? What are some other items on your list?
So some other items is Lindenwood upsetting number 9 Wisconsin and splitting. So that one is huge. And also shout out, obviously, Benton Mass.
Benton Moss,
I would say
he's
Mass.
He's former coach.
Yeah. Minnesota State, played there for a year, COVID year, as a grad student when I was there. So great kid. And then he got his, I think, yeah, first win.
Yeah,
I think as a coach.
He's an assistant coach there,
yeah.
At Lindenwood.
But that's awesome for the program. Like Elk yeah. River boy.
So here's the deal. So I'm on my way to the Rose Bowl to watch the Gophers the next day.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking at my phone, kind of going through some college hockey games results, and I look down and I look in College Hockey News app and I see Lindenwood won. They beat Wisconsin. I'm like,
crazy.
That is not true. That is a typo. That's wrong. I'm gonna go into the Twitter feeds of both schools. And
yeah.
I'm like, in fact, they did win.
They did.
I was blown away. And
it's
the
impressive.
Best part is I get off the plane that night. We're heading over to the Rose Bowl. And before we went into the football game, because we're 2 hours behind
mm-hmm.
Minnesota or the Central Time, Lindenwood's leading 2-0.
Yeah.
In the second game. I'm like, they're going to sweep the Badgers.
That would have been insane.
At Wisconsin. And again, I didn't pay much attention. We had like no service in the stadium. I mean, no service. Mm-hmm. Like it was brutal. So I didn't really have much contact with the outside world until after the game. Until
just
we
joined
got
football,
car.
How it's supposed to be.
It was so bad, so bad. But anyway, I that was interesting. That split to me really stood out to me. What does that say about the Badgers? What does that say about Mike Hastings?
That's my biggest thing with this split is, yeah, it says a lot about Lindenwood, but it says more about the Badgers. You're going to let Lindenwood, who is not like a big dog like a Michigan or a Michigan
no.
State or like any other of these teams like BU, BC. They're Lindenwood, and it's not trying to dish on them
they're
and be like blah,
blood.
Blah, blah. But, you know, they're not as a big of a program as we've seen with the Big Ten or the NCHC or even the CCHA. So for them to come into your house in Wisconsin, and Mike Hastings and Todd Kanat and all of the guys and then give that up and do a split and not sweep when everybody thinks it's going to be kind of the same thing of like the Merrimack and Minnesota State. Like that's almost the same vibes in my book, but this one's bigger because Wisconsin's number 9. Like they are ranked and you're playing at their barn and you're going to let this one get away.
Yeah.
Crazy. I bet Mike Hastings was.
That's a pairwise killer.
Oh, dude, I bet Mike Hastings was just furious. Furious, furious.
I feel like Mike Hastings, with all his Spencer Primrose trophies, doesn't really care. That's what I think. He's like, whatever, I don't care. We're going to win. We're going to be good. But what's interesting is, remember how fast they got out of the gate last year?
That's what I'm saying.
They were beating everybody last year. I was like, wow, this guy's already up to
yep.
speed. And a split with Lindenwood says that there's some turmoil there.
Something's going on behind closed doors. It just gives off a bad vibe. And like this is all speculation, but just because of that, it gives off mixed
yeah.
messages when you're in the second week of college hockey. And that, or, you know, that's
yeah.
the first full week, even if you want to go, because, you know, some of these teams didn't play, like, they just played exhibition games last
yeah, this,
week
this
or,
was
like,
last
everything
weekend
else.
Was, like, the first full weekend.
Yeah.
Now, next weekend will be everybody. Looks
everybody.
Like playing,
every
so
single person.
It
but
seems
it's
like
just,
everyone's playing.
Next it's weekend. It's a big question mark in my book.
I agree with you. All right. What's next on our list here?
SCSU sweeps Bemidji State University.
I felt like that was interesting to put in there. Because SCSU lost to the Gophers like
yep.
5-1 in an exhibition, and BSU beat UMD. I figured,
yeah.
all right, we got some. This will be a decent little series here. And we, Matt Jasper, YHH guys, building a book. I can't announce everything about it, but one of the things we're doing is home and home series.
Mm-hmm.
So he's going to be going home and home, Northern Michigan, mm-hmm. Michigan Tech, Denver. CC, and he did BSU St.
Yeah.
Cloud last weekend. He said it was pretty cool. Pretty, you know, good fans in both buildings.
Yeah, I bet.
And,
I bet.
St. Cloud State, they got a pretty seasoned team. I think that as the season goes on, and I'll say this with confidence, I think that Brett Larson's one of the top 3 coaches in the country.
Oh, absolutely.
And
I don't think that's
I'm
like
not surprised
a hot take.
No, it's not very hot, but a lot of people don't really know Brett as well because – a lot of his success came at UMD when he was coaching with Coach Scott Sandlin. So now, and he's got a national runner-up trophy in his office. I think that Brett's going to do a nice job at St. Cloud and continue to build them into a national power.
Mm-hmm.
What else you got for games and stuff?
Well, we have the NCHC.
Yeah.
8-2-1. We wrote that down. I mean, as over as looking as a conference and how they did this weekend with play.
Yeah, well, we have a lot of Minnesota teams and Minnesota-related
exactly.
kids in the NCHC. We'll
Absolutely.
Keep an eye on that all the time. You know, like, who's doing well, who's not, and you know, is it a Big Ten? Did Big Ten have a good weekend? Nah, not really. CCHA, mm-hmm. a lot of splits with the CCHA.
Yeah.
I really didn't think anyone jumped out at us other than the NCHC. Mm-hmm. And NCHC, in the 8-2-1, the one loss and the one tie out of it is from ASU. So mm-hmm. the newest member didn't really hold up their end of the bargain,
no.
but they were playing Michigan. Michigan, that's a good pairwise weekend for Michigan.
Oh,
going
absolutely.
Down to Tempe like that. A lot of these games here predict pairwise because come early November, it's going to be all conference games mm-hmm. from here on out. So these non-conference games are huge. We talked about Lindenwood. What that does to Wisconsin's pairwise, Gophers losing to Omaha isn't as bad.
No.
But beating up on Arizona's Air Force isn't great either for them. So they need to get some wins.
Mm-hmm.
When they play UMD this weekend, it's crucial for their
That's
going to
be huge. And like we said, not a home and home, which it's usually
right,
a home and home. It's going to be all up in Duluth. So
yeah.
that's going to be a huge one too as well.
And we'll get to that
and
later.
We'll get to all of that later, but another storyline that we want to talk about, Hammer getting first win for Western Michigan.
Yes, so it was a good night for the Slukinskis Saturday night. Western Michigan swept Fair State.
Mm-hmm.
Hampton Slukinski Hammer gets his first college win. What a year and a half this kid's had. He mm-hmm. was won the Frank Bremzik, Minnesota's best goalie. The next year he wins the USHL Goalie of the Year, and now he's getting dubs. And his brother transferred with him to Western Michigan. Mm-hmm. Grant, his older brother, they're playing together. He had a goal as well, his first goal, too. So what a fun night for
awesome.
The Slukinskis, you know. So I'm happy for them.
Yeah, and especially to do it, like, with Western Michigan, obviously, and just even getting anything, a first career win, I mean, that's huge because sometimes you roll into college hockey, you never know what to expect or what's going on, and I feel like for him to do that, I don't know his story, his background as much as you do, but, I mean, just hats off and caps off to him.
Great parents, Tim and Jenny Slukinski. Tim played at UND.
Oh, nice.
Jenny's Cal Marvin's granddaughter, so it's a hockey family.
Hockey family for sure.
It's a big time hockey family. I will just say that. All right, that wraps up our kind of our storylines from last
yep.
weekend. I think we'll get better storylines next weekend. We'll get to that
I think so
later.
Too.
All right, let's our segment best worst games of the week.
Yes.
Why don't you go first, ladies first.
I did talk about we talked about this in the storyline, and I want to double up on it just because I think it is huge. But my best game has to be Lindenwood upsetting number 9 Wisconsin on Friday 4-2. Now, I just want to talk about it a little bit more. Like, this upset is so big to me because you're ranked number 9. You have Mike Hastings again. You have Todd Canott. And is this – I mean, how many times has Lindenwood really upset ranked teams?
Quick note. I tried to find rankings for Lindenwood.
Mm-hmm.
Only one I could find is from College Hockey Insider, and they had them at 63rd coming into the season.
63rd, and they're upset.
I think there's only 63
9.
Teams.
Like,
64.
Quite literally.
64
they're 64,
teams.
So they're second to last in the rankings for college hockey for College Hockey Insider, and then you come out at Wisconsin to – again, a huge upset, and not even just by one goal, 4-2, dude.
To tell you what an upset was, I didn't believe it.
Like, that's how big this is.
I was like, there's no way. No possible way.
If you don't even into college hockey, if you're not into it,
it
would be a comparison.
Anyone who knows anything about college sports would go,
but it's like Lindenwood. It's like what would we put this into terms for, like, football or something, or like the NHL?
This is App State beating Michigan.
Exactly.
That's what that is.
That's how big this is.
It was, for sure. And they almost did it again, too, which was even more.
And that's, I'm like, and again, it begs the question, is Wisconsin just not playing to their degree, or is Lindenwood a dark horse?
We'll see.
I mean,
we'll
can
see.
We
so
should we
early.
Clip this Lindenwood dark horse?
No, yeah, it is.
It's good. I mean, no, that's what I'm saying. Like, let's I'm going to put this into the universe. And then if they do something and actually have a great year this year, I'm going to look like either a buffoon or a genius. And I am going to wait.
Dark horse to what? To make the tournament?
Yeah. Dark horse to make the tournament.
I wouldn't say that.
I'm all about the hot takes, dude. I'm all about it.
That's a dangerous take because I'm going to come back and get you on that one. I won't forget that one. All right. What was your worst game?
My worst game has to be, it's either going to be Merrimack versus Minnesota State.
Yep.
And I'm not even just doing it a homer. Like, how in the world? And okay, I will. And like, their student manager, which we thought last episode was going to play on Friday, did not actually play. But at the same time, you are Minnesota State coming off a split with Michigan. Huge start out the program. And you're going to lose 1-0 at home in your first home game to Merrimack.
Can you imagine how restless the Minnesota State fans must have been after
that? Trust me, I do know because I follow a lot of them and it's full of my feed and they were pissed off. Because how are you even going to 1-0? You're going to get shut out. It's not even a loss. You're going to get shut out by Merrimack at home at the Mayo Clinic Health System Events Center.
take a breath.
All of the fans in there and everything. I mean, the herd was upset. A lot of people were upset. Like Big Bag, who is like a huge follower of
Big
them.
Big Bag and Knuckles.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. Love him. Shout out. That's one of my dogs. But he was super upset. I mean, it's just a thing of you're going to plant a goose egg like that when you know you have a good squad. Like, where's Rhett Pitlick? Came in on Saturday, but you're like instant offense, but didn't you got shut out by Merrimack?
Yeah, Merrimack's not that bad, but
they played
Stonehill again. Ryan's number 64. I think they split with Stonehill the week before. They lost to Stonehill with the student manager.
Yeah,
so like this isn't exactly a blue blood.
No,
you know. So all right, so you have your best and worst. My best game would have been the Vermont St. Thomas game Friday, went 5-5. I think Vermont won in a shootout, but they did not, you know, finalize the game on Friday. So that looked like a pretty exciting
game. That's very exciting. And a little bit surprising to have Vermont, like, score that. I mean, I don't know, like, to have Vermont and St. Thomas, obviously St. Thomas last year with the injury bug and everything fell off. But towards the middle, like St. Thomas was a scary, scary team.
Really good team.
So to have Vermont do that and come into their barn and really score 5-5, like that's 10 goals. That hits the over huge.
Yes, they did hit the over, if there was such a thing. Speaking of which, and I was in Vegas, we could not. That was one more. Oh. They did not take bets at the sports book in Orleans.
Are you
on the college
kidding
hockey
me?
Games they're hosting.
I thought that was a lock.
I figured that. I was like, I want to bet on this. Like, oh, they're not taking the game. But I guess later in the night they did. On Friday they did. But like,
that's brutal.
I didn't get to the game. I had to leave for the 4 o'clock game. I had to get there by 3 o'clock.
That's brutal.
They were not taking bets. I wanted to do a bet. College hockey betting, that would have been kind of fun to do.
That's what I'm saying. I thought it was going
to
be amazing.
I would put a little money on that, you know? But
so would I.
Anyway, okay, so my best game would have been Vermont game. The worst game, I have kind of alluded to it, but was the Minnesota Air Force game. It was not pretty. Gophers came out and scored on their first shift. Connor Kurth, who ended up having a hat trick, scored the first goal. And then the first period was like 1-0. And then the Gophers it was like a shooting gallery in the second period. It was just one after another, shot after shot, goal after goal. It would end up being 8-1. It could have been, they could have gotten into double digits had they been motivated, but they just kind of lost all motivation.
All I'm going to say is that if they would have accepted the sports betting at the casino, remember when we said last episode we were going to choose Air Force Minnesota 8 over? We're going to do the over, and it was going to be 8. I mean, they hit it.
They hit the over.
They hit the over. If we could have been able to do that, we would have won money because we did say that we were going to go 8 goals combined over.
Yeah, I would have thought that would be
missed opportunity.
That'd be a good number. Okay.
Come on.
All right. So we have our best and worst is out of the way. Let's go with Jersey of the Week. We have jerseys now. Look at that. It's beautiful. Thank you to Gemini Athletic. I was able to go over there and steal 16 jerseys from them. I'm not steal like I'm keeping them steal for
they're
the
on
season.
A borrow basis.
Yeah, we're going to keep these up here, and if they need one or two back for samples, we'll be happy to deliver them back. But Chris Peterson was able to deliver them. There's a lot of cool ones up there. I mean, I was like blown away. It's like, oh yeah, yeah, here's Anchorage. And I was like, oh God, that's awesome.
Like, love the Nodak one, obviously. But they're like, you have Union, you have Northeastern, which that one is so sick. The red dog eyes. Like, I'm like, yeah, I love that one.
Really cool. They're really cool.
You also have a St. Lawrence one, which we said.
I think
was
the St. Lawrence
cool.
is the nicest one up there. That'd be my winner.
My winner has to be. Can we see it? Can everybody see it?
I think we can see it. Yep, it's
Minnesota,
for sure.
Minnesota State.
That's a good
like,
one.
Like that one with the yellow, with the purple, with the mav, with the white. Like it's just such a clean jersey. It's one of my favorites that they have because, and I know I'm a homer, but I just think it's like different. You know what I mean?
I have so many favorites up there. I'm a big Alaska Nanooks one too. That one's just super. I mean,
Huskies, Michigan Tech, good.
Okay, so like the Nanooks is such a cool name. Nanooks is such a cool name.
Yeah,
you know, it's kind of like my first job after college. I was traveling all over the country, and if I had a gopher hat on, people would be like, they were fascinated by the name. Like, oh, golden gophers, you know, like,
yeah.
Like as if to say it was like a relic of a nickname, right?
And yeah.
Because we grew up in the state. It's just, it's such a common word. Yep. Everyone used to say it. But if you leave Minnesota and you have an M on your baseball cap or a shirt or something like that, people outside of the 49 states think of Golden Gophers as kind of like we think of Nanooks. It's like, it's just this kind of random
like name.
Interesting. How many teams are called the Gophers? None. You know, the Nooks,
we're like the
not
only one.
Many, right? So it's kind to me, it's kind of a cool nickname.
Yeah.
That's a cool nickname. The
Nooks. I love
and
that.
And the jerseys, the Gemini jerseys with the full gold, the full blue on the white sleeve. Like, that's really cool.
They have a GIF, Ryan Stieg, who is part of a college hockey podcast, or not college hockey podcast, a college group chat on Twitter. Yeah. And every time they do well, it's like the polar bear, like in like a jet.
Oh, the Nanook.
And and then it's got like the glasses on, and it like puts the glasses down. Like every single time, it's like my favorite GIF he uses because it's so.
He was a writer
funny.
For St. Thomas, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Okay, I know yep. who he is. Yeah, for sure. All right. Thank you to Gemini Athletic mm-hmm. for bringing us these fantastic jerseys, and we'll bring out one of those each week. We have 16 jerseys here. We'll probably call one out each week or bring them on. But if you want to add to our collection, send me an email at youthhockeyhub@gmail.com. So you want to get your jersey up here. We'll give you a shout-out if you donate a jersey to our jersey wall. Or if you're an equipment manager at, say, St. Thomas, or your equipment manager at Augustana, I know both those guys, we would love to have your jersey mm-hmm. featured on our wall.
Correct.
All right, let's move on to the Summit Scores. Summit Orthopedic, our other sponsor of the show. Their big peak is, you know, hitting your hockey peak. And I think if you're a D1 hockey player, scoring a goal is a big deal. We'll read through some guys who did well last mm-hmm. weekend. You want to go roll through a few of these? I love you watching you pronounce some of these guys' names. I was watching you do your research today. I got the kick out of it. Justin Janicki? Janicki.
Janicki?
Justin Janicki.
That
we'll
one was
We'll get to JJ
rough.
In a minute. Yeah.
That one was rough. There's a lot of these. So I'll start out. He likes to make fun of me because I don't know them as well as he does,
you'll,
and the pronunciation is awful. I'm going to get to
you'll
know
get
him.
This one right.
This is
going
to be a bit for here. For a little bit. So Michigan versus ASU guy from Michigan, Garrett Shifsky,
state champion.
Got it. Had a hat trick on Friday for Michigan. Love to see hat tricks. Especially
that.
A Minnesota boy and over getting a hat trick. Chef's kiss. And then you have Stonehill versus Union.
Jacob Jeanette. I met Jacob's grandpa. Summer up at Northland.
Oh, really?
He had a Union hat on. I'm like, you know college hockey? He's like, yeah, how do you know college hockey? And I introduced him. He goes, oh, I know who you are. I remember when Jacob played for Duluth East, blah, blah, blah. And I were you up there that night, Ryan?
Yeah, that was when we were there on the driving range.
And he had on the driving range. Yep, that was Jacob Jeanette's grandpa that I met there. And Jacob had his first, I'm guessing that's his first college goal. So
love that.
Love
and then
that.
We have Notre Dame versus St. Lawrence. Blake.
This is gonna be. Are you putting
beyond
guy? Are you literally lying right now?
No, I don't know how to pronounce these.
This is good. I'm gonna leave you out on your limb right now and just saw it off every time.
Oh, I'm so sorry, Blake
Biondi. He won Mr. Biondi. Hockey.
Biondi
played 4 years for UMD. And
okay, I can get
year.
This next one. I can get this next one.
Oh, I bet
Danny
you
Nelson.
You got it. That a boy. That a girl. Sorry. That a boy, Danny.
That a boy.
All right. You know, if you looked in our photo library, I think I probably have 6,000 pictures of Danny Nelson. At least.
Good.
All right, let's go. Keep going.
Vermont versus St. Thomas. So you have Jen's.
This was a Friday game.
Yes. These are all Fridays, and we'll go to Saturday.
Yep.
Jen's Richards.
From Detroit Lakes.
And then he's currently playing in Vermont. Then you have Lucas Whalen.
Wallen.
Dang it, so close. Just went for it.
It's okay.
St. Thomas. Yep. You have Mason Poolman, who had 2 goals
East
on
Side
Friday.
Hockey. Yep.
Yep. And then you have Luke Leyland.
You sure it's not Luck?
Is it Luck?
No, it's not.
Okay,
it's
thank God.
Sorry.
Why are you doing
I'm working
this
you. All right, and then Cooper Gay.
Oh, Cooper Gay. What a
Love
name.
It. Love
what
it.
A name.
All right. Colgate Sacred Heart.
Jake Snyder.
Yep. You're on a roll
there
now.
There we go. Now I'm into it. I'm cooking. Let me cook. So we have right. Augustana versus LIU, Luke Mobley.
Yep. St. Louis Park kid.
And then you have UMD versus UMass Lowell. This one is going to be rough.
You got this.
Joe Molinar.
Molinar, not
Molinar.
Bad. State champion 2018 okay. for the Minnetonka Skippers.
Okay. So then we have Minnesota versus Air Force.
You got
so you
these.
Have Connor Kurth.
Yep.
And then Ryan Chesley.
Kurth had a Hattie. Ches had the...
Two goals.
Both
and
were
then,
absolute bombs, too, by the way.
Ugh.
Holy smokes.
And you have Sam Renzel.
Yep, there you go. First-round draft pick.
Love to hear that. Where's he at?
Oh,
what's
that?
Where's Sam Renzel at? Where first-round draft pick?
Chicago Blackhawks.
Okay.
All right.
You have SCSU versus BSU. Lord help my soul. Austin Bernvik.
Got it.
Okay.
He had two.
Wow.
Good player.
Good job.
Kid from Totino Grace.
We have Thor.
Come on.
By Fugly.
You're literally messing with
but us. But I swear to God, I don't know how to pronounce this.
Thor Bufflin. You've heard of
Thor
Dustin?
Thor Bufflin?
You heard of Dustin Bufflin?
That's Bufflin? That's how you pronounce that name?
Yeah.
Bufflin?
But you've never heard of Dustin Bufflin?
No.
Look him up.
Okay. That is unreal.
Yeah. You're young. Dustin Bufflin's got Stanley Cup rings.
You don't know who Dustin Bufflin is?
Yeah,
I probably do, but...
Big Buff, yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, so Thor Bufflin had... I just want to make a comment here. We have a guy who works for us, who posts all these videos on our Twitter feed. He does an awesome job, Joe Moline. Shout out to him. And he posted Goal of the Year candidate, and if you've never played hockey before and you have a Twitter feed and you live in your mom's basement, it was not the coolest goal, but it was he froze the goalie and then went Mikko Koivu backhand top shelf.
Oh.
And not only did he go top shelf, it went off the netting of top shelf and then zinged back.
Kidding.
I mean, he ripped it. I mean, that is so hard to do. Athletically, it's really difficult to pull that move off. And if you've played hockey before, you would understand how wonderful a goal it was by Thor. And it was his first college goal. And literally, there was like 6 burner accounts on it. That's not the best goal. Get in life. You know,
of course.
I'm like,
of
you
course.
Guys.
It's like, that's.
Moving on. All right, sorry.
Carter
keep going.
Rancliffe.
Carter Rancliffe.
Okay,
nice.
He
scored for BSU. So, he had 2 goals. He's a transfer in from Niagara.
Oh, nice. So that's Saturday. That's Friday goals. Now we're going to Saturday goals.
I love it. This is fun.
This is a good time for
right.
you. I don't
I
know how much we're going to.
I love this stuff.
Like, think you like to just see me squirm.
Yep. Cullen Potter. You have Porter. Cullen
Potter. Oh, it's Potter.
Yep. You got
these
that.
These were,
one.
I will say, these were like taking me forever because I don't know the names as well as Tony does.
I would have literally, I could have done this in.
In your sleep.
In my sleep.
Like, in your sleep.
When I did Summit Scorers on Friday and Saturday nights back in the olden days, I would, the men would be really quick. It's not that I don't know the women, but a lot of the women play in this conference called the NUHA on the girls' side, on the women's side. And you have to go to the internet to get each one of the games, and it was painful to go through them. Where the app on the College Hockey News app, you just flip, bing,
boom,
bing,
bing, bing,
bing,
bing,
like,
bing. That one's really nice.
It was pretty easy. Men's would take me 15 to 20 minutes to do all the games. And
took
the,
me like an
and
hour.
Women's would take me 40 minutes because I would have to go to an individual website for each box score, and it was really difficult.
Ugh.
So, all right, let's keep rolling.
Well, I have this one: Michigan State versus BC. Charlie Strammel.
Yep.
Minnesota Wild.
Minnesota Wild.
Whoop 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 whoop.
Yep.
We have St. Thomas versus Vermont again. Then we have Matthew Gleason, who is UST. Mason Poolman again. St. Thomas.
Matthew was our high school player of the year in 2020, I believe.
Love it. We also have Cooper
and
Gay.
And a Wiz Wyatt winner when he was a Pee Wee.
Oh, so, really?
Yeah, Matthew's well documented on our website. All right, keep going.
You have Cooper Gay, and then you also
have Cooper Gay, two goals. Love that.
Yeah.
Yep.
Friday and Saturday, and then you also have Max Strand for Vermont.
I got a good Max Strand for you. He was a player of the year finalist, high school player of the year finalist. He was obviously Mr. Hockey when that year. When I was there interviewing, doing his two-minute interview or whatever, there was probably 75 to 100 kids from Roseau, Minnesota in the lobby watching the interview. Because they had just gotten out of school, and they come to the rink after. Everyone just goes to the rink after school, and they skate. But they saw Max Strand was there getting interviewed from a guy from YHH, and they just sat there and watched. It was pretty cool.
So, I love that.
Yeah. All right.
So we have then UMD versus UMass Lowell. Jack Smith, UMD.
Stud. Absolute stud. Love that kid.
We're going to go to Augustana. LIU again, Luke Mobley with Augustana.
Yeah.
And then
he scored two nights in a row?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. All right.
So then we have Minnesota State versus Merrimack.
Here comes your boy, Rhett Pitlick. We love Rhett Pitlick.
I love that Rhett Pitlick is on Minnesota State. I know that kid.
I do. I love it. he's a great player. All right, next one.
St. Cloud State versus BSU. Now, this might be a top. Jackson Judding is playing phenomenal right now.
He is.
And obviously, I mean, CCHA. So I think he's going to do really well this year.
I think so.
And
he's
then
the
you,
captain.
He's the captain wearing the C. Austin Bernovic.
Again, he had three goals.
Three goals this weekend.
Yep.
Beautiful. Then you
super
have
nice kid.
Colin Ralph.
Yep.
St. Cloud State. Barrett Hall, also St. Cloud State. And then Will Magnuson.
Yeah.
Okay. This is getting a lot better.
Chaska Kid.
Yep. And then we have Notre Dame versus Clarkson. You have Danny Nelson again.
Again, you got that one.
Uh-huh.
Let's see if we get this one right.
Justin
Janicki. Yep. Can we tell you about Justin? Justin's brother, Trevor, also played at Notre Dame. And his dad, Curtis, played at Notre Dame.
Oh, so it's like a little legacy you got thing going on. I love that.
He's a draft pick of the Seattle Kraken.
Oh, nice.
Justin is.
Okay, and then you have Tristan Sarsland,
yep,
who plays for Clarkson.
He played at Benilde, and his grandpa Tony was the longtime coach at Elk River.
Oh, really? Yep.
And won a state championship in the early 2000s with the Elks.
Nice. And then you have BU versus Union, BU Jack Harvey. We roll into Western versus Ferris State.
We already talked about Grants Lukinski.
Thank you. Thank you for saying that. I feel like I was going to get it, but then I was like looking at it and I'm like going cross-eyed right now. Like
it's a hard one.
Slukinski? I can't.
Slukinski. You're going to say that name a few more times this season. So
Slukinski.
Bone up on the Slukinski name. You're going to say that name a few times.
This is going to get clipped all over the internet. Oh, my God.
All right.
Okay. We're going to go Minnesota versus Omaha Mason Nevers.
You got that one, right?
Or Minnesota.
I think Mason Nevers is about to break a record for blocked shots by a University of Minnesota player. Yeah, I think that's coming up. The Gopher Game Notes Twitter guy. He and I have been trading some texts and said that if you got a picture of Nevers, I would love it. So I think that would be, I think he's got something coming up. Nevers is going to have a milestone here.
How many career games is he at? Do you know?
I don't know, but he's on his fifth year.
Ah.
He did year because he came in COVID.
COVID. So he's got a COVID year.
He's on his fifth year of hockey. So he's going to get that stat bump because you get that. And he played a lot his freshman year. Mm-hmm. A lot. I remember tweet because it was during COVID, and I remember tweeting a lot of those games because like what else am I gonna do. We were in that break, that November December break, where there was no one playing hockey. And I'm like, oh, I'm just gonna tweet Gopher games. You know, I'm gonna tweet any game I can get online, you know. So I tweeted those. I tweeted NCHC had a what do they call it, a pod? Did they have a pod in Omaha? Was it in Omaha?
I think it was in Omaha.
They had a pod in Omaha. So I tweeted all those games too, like, why not, you know. Cost me like $10 to get the buy it online or something like that. So I just sat in there.
That was a crazy time.
Yeah, it was. It was. All right, next one.
We have last but not least CC versus Northern, Max Burkholder. Burkholder.
I don't have the year, but he was Bantam Player of the Year like 2019-ish, somewhere in there.
We need to fact check that.
Yeah, see, he was Bantam Player of the Year. I don't know what year. I can't remember off the top of my head.
Okay, so now we have that, thank God, because my sanity was about to go through the roof. I needed to.
Yep. You'll learn. You're going to learn.
We're going to learn it. We're going to, and if I butcher your name, please, I'm so sorry.
You're going, doing just fine.
So now we're going to look forward to games of the week. So this segment, obviously, we're just going to look for one of our favorite games of the week and talk about it a little bit and see where they're going to be.
I also think it's important just to kind of like, it doesn't have to be just Minnesota teams as teams of interest.
Just like
but
anybody.
These are all, like the Augustana-Omaha one, we'll get to that in a minute.
Yeah.
But I just, so many Minnesota kids in these games. That, I mean, if you're
like,
Summit,
that's what our podcast
if you're
is
tracking
about.
Summit scores, these are eight teams you're going to want to keep an eye on this
yep,
weekend.
Yep, absolutely.
You know what
on
I mean?
Saturday,
we're
I'm
doing
be like,
that bit, you know. So, all right, obviously Minnesota UMD, that's number one, and it's not because I went to school there. But this is, I mean, there's, I did a tweet. I went as a fan. I was not covering the game a few years ago, and I did a tweet. There was, it was sold out, but there was probably like 80 empty seats, and I said, nothing better than watching, it was like 31 Minnesota kids play in a sold-out barn.
Yeah.
And like, sold out, I see some empty seats.
And of I'm like, course. You're like, okay, it's basically
the point.
Sold
the
out.
Point.
Like,
here.
It's basically to that point.
For
like,
me, that night, watching kids that I had watched play since they were squirts, like 30-plus of them, I know their name, I know their parents, I know how it works. It's so fun to watch that series. That's probably my favorite series to watch, you know, from just a pure fan perspective. There's just so many Minnesota kids out there.
Agreed.
100%.
So this is going to be a fun one for me to keep an eye on all weekend long. So
I think, too, this one, obviously, producer gave us a little bit of note, but first, what, non-home and home? It's, like, all solely up in Duluth.
Yep,
yes,
first
not
at
all
home
in Duluth.
And
it's not home
years.
Home. It's been...
Because that's a tradition, isn't that?
Decades.
Yep.
Decades. I mean, into the 90s. They were doing that. So 20, 30 years away.
What's the switch up?
Who knows? I think, here's my guess, okay?
Scheduling.
So last year when St. Thomas played the Gophers at the X, I was in the press room and people were asking Bob about his schedule. What do you have a schedule? He goes, honestly, I would schedule all these teams. Mm-hmm. I just can't because of certain, you know, because of conference requirements, right? So... he says, I would love to play these guys. I would love to play Mankato. I would love to play St. Cloud. I would love to play them all because of all the in-state rivalries. I would love to get these games in. So, like, again, UND's not on the schedule this year, right? Mm-hmm. So guess who's on the schedule? UMD.
Yep.
So the thing about the home and home is I guarantee you just from a – this is just – I don't know this for fact, but it's pretty obvious that UMD Minnesota – aren't going to be on the schedule for a few years to come.
Okay.
So because of that, they're going to like we want our money. It's our turn to host, so we're going to take our two, and then the Gophers will get a UMD Minnesota in a few years or next year or what is it?
It's officially been 10 years since the CCHA was disbanded.
That came out of the blue, producer Ryan.
Where? What are you talking about? The CCHA
or the.
WCHA.
WCHA, there it is.
I was like, wow.
I was like going to say, wait, what's going on here?
Yeah, but that is, I mean, UMD and Minnesota have played a lot since the disbanding, and it was always home and home. So this year, I'm guessing, because Bob's, you know, in a pickle. Everybody wants to play the Gophers, mm-hmm. and he wants to play everybody, but, like, I'm guessing they went, hey, if you can't guarantee us two years back-to-back, we'll take our home, and then the next time we play, it's going to be two at Minnesota.
Yeah, that's what it has to be.
It's what it has to be, I'm guessing. So, all right, let's go. Well, who's going to in any of these? You got to pick one sweep out of these four games, out of these four series. Will you pick a Minnesota UMD sweep? If I'm picking one of these, I think MSU is the most vulnerable to be swept. But I'm going to go homer on this, and I'm going to say Minnesota will go to UMD and sweep the Dogs.
I was
going to
say that.
And it's
I was
not because I
that.
Think they're that appreciably better. I just think the Gophers are going to have a rough week of practice after losing to Omaha. And there were signs, again, granted it was against Air Force, but there were some signs of that Gopher team that looked – extremely impressive the way they move the puck. Mm-hmm. Their blue line just control. I think they got a better blue line than UMD. UMD is real young. And I know it's going to be hard to go get a sweep up in Duluth, but that's going to be my pick is Minnesota sweeping UMD mm-hmm. this weekend.
I was going to say Minnesota sweeping UMD, or I was even going to go with Michigan sweeping SCSU?
Yeah.
I was.
Yeah. Yeah, that's tough.
It's a tough one, but.
That's a splitter to me. That's a split.
You think so?
Yeah, and I think that MSU will dig deep and they'll get a win.
That's my biggest thing is I mean, how good is UND this year? Like we've also known UND as always this big powerhouse, and you know they're the Fighting Hawks. People are gonna hate me that I say that.
That's okay.
But they're the Fighting Hawks, and you know they're this legacy in college hockey. But how good are they really this year?
We don't know yet.
Exactly, and I just don't.
I don't think they even know.
So I think that one's a split.
Yeah.
Because I think, especially for Minnesota State, you're really going to have another home series against the Fighting Hawks, and you're going to split or lose. But, like,
they couldn't have had a better home schedule.
Against Merrimack, like last week. I don't know. I think they probably are like,
gotta, you gotta
go
get
time.
Over it. You have to get over it.
I do.
All right. We'll go next year is UMD. MSU, I'm thinking that's a split.
Yeah, I do.
Really do too.
I do think that's a split. I just don't think that Minnesota State with the weekend they had last weekend and everything else. I see them splitting a lot of games. Like, do you know what I'm like?
For
I just
Minnesota
feel
State?
Like that vibe this year. Like, there's a lot of splits. Like, how many will we actually be sweeping? Are we that good of a? I thought we were gonna be like when we came from Michigan.
Minnesota State?
Well, when we came from Michigan the first week, I was like, holy crap. Holy crap.
I love her
and then
talking
you have it.
We. She's throwing
I know,
we
she's got third
her.
Person in there, too.
Who's we
me,
out there?
Me, sorry. I said, yeah, I said me,
I know
week.
You worked in the media department for Minnesota State, but you're weeing a lot on Minnesota State right now.
It's really hard for me not to
let
do
go.
That.
I gotta let it go.
I gotta let the homer flag
it's okay.
go.
It's okay. It takes a while.
It does take me a long time.
It takes a while to let it go. All right. St. Cloud State goes to Michigan, goes to Yost. I'd love to see if St. Cloud State has ever played at Michigan before. That's not something in my estimation. I don't think they ever have. But
I don't know.
I think it's pretty cool.
I think it's a really great series.
They played each other last year at St. Cloud. So this is a home and home.
I think it's kind of cool how you had Minnesota State go there, and now you have St. Cloud State go.
Yeah.
I just kind of like that, you know, CCHA, NCHC,
awesome.
Big
Ten.
Ryan
is ready to hit the button already.
Yeah.
St. Cloud State University men's hockey team played at the University of Michigan on November 25th, 2023.
Oh.
What?
They played there last year?
25th, 2023.
They played there last year.
St. Cloud did?
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was at St. Cloud.
No, it was in Ann Arbor. Mm-hmm. No kidding.
I'm fact checking that.
No kidding.
We'll see.
I don't think that's true. All right. Anyway,
we'll hit producer Ryan.
Next up, Augustana goes to Omaha.
Yeah.
I wouldn't predict a sweep here. Omaha is
on both sides.
They're flying high. They just beat the Gophers. They are partying. They're playing Augustana, the new kid on the block. They're gonna look past them. And Augustana's going to go in there. They beat UND 2 weeks ago.
They split last year, though. Augustana came to Omaha, and I'm pretty sure they split last year, too.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think it's a split.
I think the thing about it is, like, because I know a lot of people, because, you know, I used to work for Minnesota State because I don't shut up about it, but I also used to work for Omaha and work with Omaha, so I was there last year, like we talked about. Baxter Arena, in one of my opinions, a very underrated barn.
Oh, no question.
It gets so loud. It's a beautiful setup. It's gorgeous in there. The fans are rabid. It's hockey in Nebraska, you know. They don't have any high school hockey. That's all they really have besides a club team in Lincoln for the Huskers. I mean, It's a really cool place. I will say they need to use it.
This is the best you can see in the state of Nebraska.
Oh, without a doubt, 100%. But yeah. I do think that, you know, even with that on their side, last year Augustana did beat them and split them, and they had a split. So maybe they sweep. Maybe they're feeling the juice, like you said, maybe. I don't know. I don't see it. It's a really toss-up at this point because, like we talked about, there's, what, like 14 new kids on Omaha, so they're just still really young. Maybe they're building. Maybe they got some kinks. Like, they haven't been home yet, so who knows?
Yeah, yeah. I think that one's a split as well. All right, let's roll into some news here.
That's New Heights. That's not us. Please don't copyright me.
Brent Solomon commits from Champlin Park to the Badgers. He's the leading scorer in the high school elite league. It's fun. You go into your library to pull pictures for a tweet. Mm-hmm. It's so cool to see what's in our library. I'm like, oh yeah, here he is. Here's a Pee Wee.
Like, boom.
Here he's playing the Bantam Elite League. Here he's like, I have pictures of Solomon from everywhere. It's just fun to see how many years that we've seen all these kids play, mm-hmm. and they go into our library and pull out pictures from them playing. And he's doing really well. He's super fast. I can see why he's doing well in the Elite League. He plays a really structured game, and that. In those situations, the Elite League is a little bit unstructured. He's going to do really well in an environment like that.
Yeah.
And he'll do great at Wisconsin. I'm sure that's why Kanader came up there, saw him, and said, hey, this is our kind of guy. He'll play a couple years of juniors, and he'll come into our program just like we did at Mankato. The formula is going to work at Wisconsin. It's just going to take them a few years to get it going.
Well, so. And Todd Knotter is such an underrated recruiter. I think he's one of the best top five.
My eyes. He's one of the best.
That's
he's
what
the
I'm
best
saying.
Evaluator of talent.
Well, and I think a lot of
area.
Because I worked with him, a lot of people. I don't know if a lot of people know that. Oh, just outside of Minnesota and everything else. But Todd Knott is one of the best recruiters, if not the best, in college hockey. Again, like you said, like it was on game days. Like we would have game days. I would be out like waiting for the guys to come out of the tunnel, and he's about to get ready to coach to step onto the bench, and he's leading a recruiter down the hall. Like, he's leading a recruit and going, this is what's going on during game days. He would always show them during game days, and having the assistant coach do that for a kid while you're supposed to be playing in, like, what, 30 minutes or whatever, that's so cool for him. And he did that a lot, and he was, you know, just the nicest guy. I have nothing but amazing things to say about Todd.
All right. We had a note that came in. I sent a note that came in to you about a news item. This is a really big detail to the whole CHL.
Oh, it's huge.
Formula,
it's a game changer.
Right? So just kind of some people after our show last week, people actually listened.
Woo, thank you.
And they listened to what we had to say about the CHL and players coming into college hockey from the CHL. And now if they're Canadian-born players and the NIL, it's very interesting that they can, and I know this to be fact, and I can share an example. What to be fact is Canadian-born players aren't allowed to receive cash payments while in the United States. They can't be take documented payment. So if you're a football player from Toronto, say, and you went to the University of Michigan, there'd be no NIL money for the kid from Toronto who came there. And the same goes for Connor Bedard. If he were to go from BC. If he were to do that and play for Michigan or Minnesota or Minnesota
Stonehill
State.
Stonehill.
Yeah, wow.
It's a big get for Stonehill.
He would not have been given any NIL money. So
and
that
I think
might
that's...
be some, but my theory on that is, and don't take this wrong, hockey fans, but hockey is somewhat of a rich kid sport. And so a lot of these kids now, if they're coming into the Gophers or Michigan, NIL isn't a big deal to them. I got this kind of money. I don't think there's a lot of money being handed out in the NIL department. They are getting some NIL deals.
Yeah.
But they're not They're not Tennessee quarterback NIL.
No, they're
deals.
Not college football
life-changing.
Level, college basketball
not life-changing
level.
Money.
He's not going to be next to Shadur Sanders on the KFC commercial.
Correct.
Exactly, right? Like, it's not going to be those things at all. And I wish that was kind of the same for college hockey. Like, there are some places, like there's a place in Omaha who tries to get kids to do that and gives a little bit money back from like an agency standpoint. But it's not like anything. It's like, oh, you come and do this and make an appearance, we'll give you $300 or something of that nature. It's not like $250,000 for this and this. But that is a huge wrinkle in the plan. And just overall in general, look at how many kids, not just from Minnesota, but kids in college hockey that are from Czech, that are from Canada, that are from like all of these places, a ton. And they're not getting paid at all.
Yeah, well, they'll find ways.
Loopholes.
I was given a loophole, and I won't get into the loophole, but I do know this. We had when we ran the Gopher Camp, we had a Canadian kid who worked for us, and we weren't able to write him a check. We could only pay him in cash.
Interesting.
Because he couldn't take a payment.
Like you said, documented payment.
Documented payments.
There it's, it is.
Yeah, so
okay.
It's not that big a deal, but it's just a fact. And that makes sense by the reason that these Canadian kids aren't going to be able to sign big NIL deals.
Exactly.
But I still don't think it's going to be that. I don't think it's going to change the NIL game or
change
it. It's just going to make it one. It's going to be another hurdle for the coaches if they were to try to lure a player in. All right, last news item here, and this is not college hockey related, but it's college hockey related.
But we need to talk about it.
Yeah, a guy named Lenny Childs. Lenny was an assistant coach at Union last year, and we'll call him a rising star in the coaching ranks. And Lenny was the first African-American coach to be the head coach at a USHL franchise. He was fired after four games.
Yeah, isn't this the Lancers?
What's that?
Omaha Lancers.
Yeah. So, four games.
Bad look.
That is a horrible, horrible
I hate to say this.
I mean, you got to give a guy a year. You got to give him six. Like, something obviously is wrong in Omaha, and it has been for a few years. They had some stuff go down last year. It's been rough. And you lived in Omaha, so I would love to get your take on the ownership problems and things are going on with the Lancers.
Yeah, I actually covered Lancer games, so I can take this one into my own hands and talk about it. But the Lancers haven't been good for a while. This has been a thing. They've struggled. They're a struggling franchise. They still have people out there, but it's not as big. There's something going on with them, though. There's a bigger detail that we're missing because some people go to the games, but it should be more packed. It's a fun atmosphere. It's like Liberty Credit Union First. It's like a name like the Mayo Clinic House, you know?
Yeah, long.
It's a long name that
names.
I whatever. Too many effing names. But something's going on because, like, they're so bad. Like, last year, I think they won, like, four games or something.
Like
they did not win any, like, please, producer Ryan, like, look at that. But they, like, did not win many games at all. Like, and it was really hard because we would go to the games to cover and be like, okay, if they win, like, do an interview. And every single time I would do a game, they would lose.
They would lose.
So I'm like, why the F am I here kind of a deal?
Yeah, they are not a strong team.
No,
But my point is, like, why would you fire a coach after four games? It would seem like you'd want to give them a longer leash there.
Well, because the thing about Omaha, in my opinion, is they're, like, expecting somebody to come in and be a Mike Hastings, what he was, and, like, be good and do all this, and that's not going to happen. Or maybe it could, but you got to give him more than four games. That's insane, especially to have the coach that they had. And, again, producer Ryan, how many games did they win last year?
They won 16, they lost 43, lost 3 in overtime, only won 7 at home.
See, that's what I'm saying. You're only going to win 7 at home and 16. I never interviewed a kid when I went to a Lancer game because they lost every single one. And the ones they did win, I wasn't covering because we're like, why would we go when they lose a lot and you don't know? But that's my biggest thing is, like, you're going to only win 16 games last year and you get four games into this season, hire a new head coach who's up and coming, and then you fire him?
I just don't
Something's
get it.
Going on behind closed doesn't doors. Something's
sense.
Going on in
doesn't
Omaha. Sorry.
2 years ago, they won 17 games.
Yeah, they're
See,
on
they've
a roll.
Always been bad.
Yeah.
Like, not always. There was a time with Mike Hastings,
they won a Clark
you know.
Cup. They won a Clark Cup. Or they were in a Clark Cup final about 7 or 8 years ago.
Yeah, they weren't always bad, but these last couple of years, it has been a struggle. And a lot of people who watch USHL hockey or in the like have kids there and
Look
know
up
about
Clark
the
Cup champions. They might have won a Clark Cup. They beat Chicago or they lost to Chicago like 7 years ago. But
I
since
just can't
then,
believe four games in and you've
been
fired.
They've
years.
Been like a 6 or 7 year run where it's been rough.
Rough.
Real rough. Okay, do you want to read off all of our follow us now, then I'll close it out?
Yeah. Well, do we want to wait for him to look up if
no, we'll
they
get
won?
It.
We'll get into it. Okay, so if you've enjoyed this podcast as much as I've enjoyed this podcaster, but me butchering the Summit scores or anything else, and if you wanted to hear us throughout our college hockey season that we'll be covering this, make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Youth Hockey Hub, or YHH put in there. Also, you will follow us on Twitter, find all of our stuff, not just college hockey, but we also have women's hockey, we have high school hockey, boys, girls, we have podcasts, we have like everything you can think of on Twitter. We also have an Instagram, a TikTok, and this is available as one of our many podcasts on Spotify, Apple Music, Google Play, anything you can
everywhere.
Think of. Everywhere you can get your podcasts, that's where we will be. So this week in college hockey with Marissa Voss, Tony Scott, subscribe, like, follow, MySpace.
You name it.
Tumblr.
We're on it.
Pinterest.
Oh, we got it right here.
Here we go.
2007, 2008.
So that's a while ago.
It was then they must have lost it. Look up when Chicago won it. What years did Chicago win the?
Chicago Steel.
Yeah.
2020, 2021, 2016, 2017.
It was 2016. 2016. They beat Omaha in the 2016 Clark Cup final. I don't know why I know that, but I just happened.
It's in your head.
To know that.
You're like a vessel of just knowledge up in there.
I just know that. all right. Well, and thank you to our sponsors, Gemini Athletic and Summit, and our producer, Ryan Maney. Good job today, Ryan.
Woo-hoo, you kicked some job, butt. Good job, Ryan.
Every week, boys.
Maybe we'll bring you back next week. For Marissa and Tony, thanks for tuning in. We'll see you around the rink.